Welcome to the History of Midnight Club, a video documenting the entirety of the racing game series Midnight Club. Developed by Rockstar San Diego and published by Rockstar Games, Midnight Club is undoubtedly one of the most iconic racing game franchises to date. The series spans over four huge games, the latest being Midnight Club Los Angeles, released in October 2008 for the Xbox 360, PlayStation 3, and on the PSP as Midnight Club Los Angeles Remix. In this video, we'll go over the creation and history of this beloved racing game franchise. My name is Fegus, and without any further ado, let's begin. It all began with Colombian artist Diego Angel. Diego was highly talented and interested in 3D animation during a time where computer animation was still very much in its infancy. While 3D computer animation had existed since the 1960s, it was the 1980s where it really started to flourish due to technological advancements and the affordability of computer hardware. The 80s was also when 3D animation would see more commercial use, like the first 3D animated music video, and the first movie using CGI sequences. Diego Angel saw the potential in computer animation and eventually started up a software firm called Angel Studios, which had been located in Carlsbad, California. Angel Studios originally produced 3D work for various media, including fully-fledged films and music videos, with their most notable work at the time having worked on the visual effects for the cult classic film The Lawnmower Man and Peter Gabriel's hit song, Kiss That Frog. While Angel Studios were making a name for themselves in the 3D animation business, they wanted to steer away from the movie business and try out something completely new. Something interactive that would involve heavy use of animation. Video games. In February of 1995, Angel Studios joined Nintendo's Dream Team. The Dream Team were a group of software and video game studios who would release games for the up-and-coming Nintendo Ultra 64 system, which would eventually be released as the Nintendo 64 in 1996. We've waited patiently to enter the video game industry until a vehicle was developed that allowed us to fully display our talents. The Nintendo Ultra 64 is that vehicle. In 1996, the first video game that Angel had created assets for would be released, this being Zono's Sega Saturn game, Mr. Bones, which Angel Studios made the artwork and cutscenes for. As part of Nintendo's Dream Team, they had released two sports games and the critically acclaimed Resident Evil 2 port for the Nintendo 64 in 98 and 99 respectively. There were two other games that remained unreleased, with one unreleased game being a vehicular combat game codenamed Buggy Boogie. This game would have seen vehicles eat each other and absorb their DNA to overtake their powers. However, after 6 months of development, Nintendo president Shigeru Miyamoto was unsatisfied with the game and canned it, telling Angel Studios to work on a fantasy golf game for the system, which would also remain unreleased. This unreleased vehicular combat game did lay out the blueprint for their next project, which would also have a heavy basis on driving. Angel Studios were interested in doing business with Microsoft for a while, initially attempting to sell a 3D vehicle simulator project to the Monolith Company. However, Microsoft had something else in mind for the studio. The idea of an open-world racing game came when two Microsoft employees attempted to cross a heavily crowded street in Paris. This idea of an open-world PC racing game was proposed to Angel Studios by Microsoft. At first, they were hesitant to accept the offer, considering how huge the project would be, but Angel took the offer anyway. This resulted in the creation of Midtown Madness, a fully-fledged open-world 3D racing game that would take place in Chicago, with the state being specifically chosen as it was the location featured in various car chase scenes from several films, the Blues Brothers being a particular inspiration. The game would then go on to be released on April 30th, 1999, to alright sales and favorable reception by critics. The game was praised for its open world, gameplay, and controls, also being very distinct from other racing games coming out at the time. After the release of Midtown Madness, New York-based video game publisher Rockstar Games started to show a huge interest in Angel Studios. We'll be right back. around mid-1999, Rockstar Games eventually struck up a deal with Angel Studios for them to work on two up-and-coming planned titles for the PlayStation 2. These being Getaway, a driving game with the narrative of having to smuggle goods from one checkpoint to another under a strict time limit. This would later be renamed to Smuggler's Run. The other title being an illegal street racing game, Midnight Club Urban Racing, renamed to Midnight Club Street Racing later on into development. The name was derived from the Japanese street racing team, Midnight Club, an illegal street racing association that was active from 1987 and eventually disbanded in 1999 due to an incident where a highly fatal chain reaction crash occurred during a race between the Midnight Club and a fellow biker gang. A reference to the Midnight Club team could also be seen in the Japanese kanji letters, which translates to Wangan, or Bayshore, which is a highway in Tokyo where the Midnight Club used to host and execute races. Riding on the cultural sway towards import tuna culture of the 2000s, popularized by the Fast and Furious in 2001, Angel Studios began creating a game that felt similar to Midtown Madness, with the open-world driving feel, however adding towards the allure of street racing would include cars with large body kits and wings to immerse the player in the game world. Three cities were planned for the game: New York, London, and Tokyo. New York most likely having been chosen because of Rockstar's headquarters being based within the Big Apple. Tokyo eventually ended up being removed from the game later on during development to assure that Midnight Club would make its release date on time. During the development of Midnight Club in around 1999, a few Angel Studios developers visited several illegal street racing events to get ideas for the game. These activities were recorded and released as a DVD film in 2002 called Mischief. This movie also features the yellow Mazda MX-6 featured on the cover of the game.
We're hiding from the cops, we're at the street races, and they blocked every exit, so we're hiding in a cage, a garbage cage. We got our cars hidden, I got mine covered with cardboard because it's yellow.
The vehicle in question is owned by car enthusiast Dustin Walls, who has appeared in many of the Mischief clips. Here's a fun fact about that cover image. Rockstar actually closed off Times Square just to shoot the cover, with the shot alone including over 40 crewmen. In order to shoot the game's intro, Rockstar blocked several main roads off while filming in New York. Rockstar basically told Dustin and the other drivers featured in the intro to just race through Manhattan, while the Rockstar filming crew drove near in a minivan to record the event. The game would eventually be released on October 25th, 2000 for the PlayStation 2. Midnight Club, you start off as a cab driver in New York wanting to make a name for himself. The player learns of a mysterious racing gang called the Midnight Club and is very interested in joining. In order to gain a spot in the club, you'd have to race Emilio Sanchez, a Hispanic lowrider freak who loves to think that he's unbeatable.
You wanna race Emilio? Ha! You ain't got nothing I'm scared of!
In order to start new races, you need to find your rivals, dubbed Hookmen, cruising around the city and tail them to get to the race start. Alternatively, you could also use your cell phone to call them and start a pink slip race. In addition to Emilio, the other New York hookmen were Larry Mueller, a very serious guy who always wants to get straight to the point.
I'm Larry Mueller. They don't mess with me in Queens.
And Keiko Hatano, a harsh, feisty, and sassy driver who likes to be quick and aggressive on the road.
I'm Keiko Hatano, the hottie behind the wheel. I like to drive very fast.
Once you beat all of the hookmen in New York, you'll have to go against the New York champion, Kareem Windross, who has the hottest and fastest car in town, a PT Phoenix.
My name's Kareem, and I am so fresh that the girls can't settle for nothing less. I'm the champ!
His extreme confidence only being exceeded by the speed of his ride.
Your luck just don't run out, does it?
Upon defeating Kareem, you unlock the second location in the game, London. Once arriving, you then have to start challenging some of the London drivers, which are Lucas Hal Jones, a younger driver who you wouldn't want to trust with your sister, and definitely not on the road either. He sees himself as the best street racer around, and he'll do anything to take the win.
Yo, word up. HJ on the mic.
Emily Morton, a girl who seems to have it all. The body, the money, the clothes, and most importantly, a fast car. She'll take anything if it hasn't been handed over to her already.
You'll never catch up with me, Emily Morton, fastest girl in town.
And the London champion, Darren Thurrock, a rude and methodical bloke who has one of the fastest cars in the world, the Armada.
Darren Thurrock, fastest man in London.
Fortunately for you, his skills really don't match the car that much, giving you an opportunity to take his spot in the Midnight Club.
God almighty.
After all these races, you eventually get to challenge the world champion, Anika. She's a very secretive person, originally from Japan, who came to London to see if anyone could challenge her title as the world champion. She drives the Zenda Alpha, one of the fastest cars in the game. After defeating her, you'll earn the title of world champion while Anika flees back home to Japan.
Now you have everything. I am humbled. Leave me, please.
The game features 10 original vehicles, with every car having 3 of its own versions, one stock and the other 2 customized versions of the same car, which technically stretches the car list to 30 race vehicles. These range from a taxi to sports cars and tuners, or muscle cars and pickup trucks. The vehicles in the game are fictional but have designs based off real-world cars, such as the Fasuto GT being based off a mix between the Toyota MR2 and the Mitsubishi 3000 GT, or the Bueno being based off the Chevrolet Impala. Despite it featuring unlicensed vehicles, many cars do feature real-world aftermarket part logos on their designs, like Veilside, G-Ready, and Top Secret, amongst others. Most of the vehicles also have nitrous equipped to them, which will give you a nice advantage during races. The cars also sustain some damage and do deform whilst also being damaged. A meter in the HUD indicates how far you are from totaling out your car. Despite only featuring 2 locations, those being London and New York, both tracks have tons of recognisable landmarks. These would include Central Park, Times Square, the London Eye, and far more. Here's a fun fact. London was featured before in Midtown Madness 2, another racing game by Angel Studios that came out a month before Midnight Club. Remarkably, London and Midnight Club had been remodeled from scratch with a slightly different layout, despite the fact that both games ran on the Angel game engine. Midnight Club was very innovative when it came to racing, as the game had a very heavy basis on shortcuts in order to find the fastest route to win, making interesting use of the open world. AI drivers also make extensive use of this. The strategy of racing was emphasized even more in newer Midnight Club titles, making for this distinct, high-energy style of racing made the key trait of the franchise. Considering Midnight Club is about illegal street racing, police reinforcement would obviously become a mechanic to feature within the game.
Hey buddy, you got some new friends, be careful.
The police are aggressive and will do anything in their power to slow you down and arrest you. Police cruisers don't spawn in free roam, it is only scripted to show up during certain events. The game had a pretty distinctive handling model from most racing games coming out at the time. By using the handbrake and the joystick, you would be able to make your car slide in whatever direction you wanted it to go. Using the handbrake to turn is pretty much a necessity most of the time, as otherwise you probably won't be able to master the tight corners without it. This way of maneuvering would become important in the following Midnight Club games as well. During races, opponents tend to taunt you quite a lot, which will either annoy the hell out of you or give you more of a motivation to win. Or both.
I'm so fast, I always finish first. Ask my girlfriend, she'll tell you.
Excuse me, boys, but I am going to win.
Mira, mira, payaba, payaba, bye-bye, say bye-bye to the big man, Emilio!
This, however, did give the characters more personality and attitude. This would play a side role in later iterations of Midnight Club, however, we cannot forget this feature and where it began. Midnight Club is split into 2 modes, the Career Mode and something else called Arcade Mode. Arcade Mode is basically the equivalent to the Quick Race Mode seen in a lot of other racing games. You can play event types that were seen through the Career Mode and some that weren't featured at all. Some of the arcade features were Cruise, which basically is just free roam. You're able to select what time of the day it will be, the weather conditions, level of traffic, and the amount of pedestrians roaming around. Head-to-head, a simple 1v1 checkpoint race. There was Waypoint, a race with unordered checkpoints where you'd have to find the fastest route to win. And Capture the Flag, a mode where you have to grab the flag and deliver it to your base without the other team stealing it from you. The team who delivers the most flags before the time limit ends, wins. The game also features two-player split-screen for each of these modes. The in-game soundtrack was composed exclusively for the game by artists signed under the Moving Shadow record label. The game features 10 tracks, 5 for each area, which were all composed by drum and bass acts Dom and Roland and Surgeon. Midnight Club had received favorable reception upon release, with many critics praising the fun and simple gameplay, the game's open-ended cities, exploration, and controls. However, the game was panned for its bland visuals and plot, with it being one of the first racing titles to be out on the fastest-selling console of all time. It was bound to sell pretty well, and it did. Midnight Club Street Racing managed to sell 1.9 million copies worldwide on the PlayStation 2 alone. A year later, in November 2001, a Game Boy Advance version of Midnight Club Street Racing was released. This port was not developed by Angel Studios, but instead by Rebellion Developments, who are now known for being the people behind the popular and well-praised Sniper Elite titles. The Game Boy Advance port stayed pretty faithful to the PlayStation 2 release, with it featuring most vehicles, both New York and London, and the story we saw in the PlayStation 2 version, only this time in 2D. This port received negative to mixed reviews, with it being largely criticized for having repetitive gameplay, incompetent AI, and overall just being very lackluster compared to the PS2 release. Midnight Club Street Racing became Angel Studios' most successful project, and it would only seem inevitable to branch the game out to a full series. And so, not too long after finishing the first Midnight Club, they started working on a sequel. After the success of both Midnight Club Street Racing and Smuggler's Run, they quickly started to work on the sequels to both games, with Midnight Club 2 setting out to be the team's biggest project to date. The idea was to make Midnight Club Street Racing, but expanded and with greater detail. For the successor to Midnight Club 1, the game would feature three cities this time around, those cities being Paris, Los Angeles, and the previously omitted Tokyo. Whilst most other companies at the time were more concerned with how close their cities matched to their real-world counterpart, Angel Studios were far more focused on building their cities for the high-speed racing action the game would become known for. Designing the cities for speed was key to the developers, and they wanted to make sure the races stayed as fast-paced as possible. They still did care about detail, however, with each city having around a million polygons put into them, along with 80 miles of road and 2,500 destructible props, such as lampposts, garbage cans, and far more per city. Lighting plays a huge role during development in defining the mood for each area. Los Angeles is warm and bright, Paris is dark and gloomy, while Tokyo is electric and filled with neon and fluorescence. Extensive research, planning, and testing went into making these cities, with each location featuring recognizable landmarks such as the Eiffel Tower, Shibuya, the Hollywood sign, and far more. Each location took around 6 months to develop. Car models and designs were also going to be a huge improvement from the first Midnight Club. Each car would require extensive research to model, and the design team would spend around a month to craft a single car. Angel Studios started designing vehicles by obtaining as much reference material as possible from actual real-life racing, similar to what they did for the development of Midnight Club Street Racing. Southern California is a major center for street racing activity, and many of the staff members at Angel Studios were car and bike fanatics. So there were still a ton of ideas and concepts floating around the office come development time. Angel Studios liked car damage in their titles, as they're obsessed with physics and visual effects. This is one of the main reasons why Angel Studios never really made an effort to include licensed vehicles in the game, combining that with the fact that they much rather preferred creating their own materials and designs than using licensed vehicles, and in addition to that, you'd also get a far more in-depth damage model than what existed before Midnight Club 2. Midnight Club's plot was widely criticized for being lackluster, with the characters in particular having little to no personality outside of their dialogue. Angel Studios sought out to improve on that. When racing against the AI, you don't want to feel like you're racing against robots. For this reason, Angel Studios designed Midnight Club 2 to give you the feeling of challenging real members of an illegal street racing underground, each with their own personality and racing style. The game features 28 characters in total, all with their own cheesy personality and style. In addition to having their own visual style, characters also had their own driving style. Others try to ruin everything for you, like ramming traffic cars or lampposts into your way to slow you down, while others are just straight up cheaters.
When I say go, we hit it. 3, 2, 1, go!
Instead of introducing their characters by simple text boxes like the first game did, all characters have their own 3D animated cutscenes, which have since become very dated, but still have a really cheesy charm to them that you can actually appreciate. Rumors about a sequel to Midnight Club Street Racing started floating around as early as 2001. However, the game was officially announced by Rockstar Games in May of 2002. To quote, Midnight Club turned a lot of heads at the launch of the PlayStation 2 with its frantic gameplay, open plan racing, and unique attitude. With Midnight Club 2, we're pushing the boundaries even further by adding more cities, tricked out vehicles, stylized characters, and a myriad of extra features to keep the series moving forward. In November 20th of 2002, parent company of Rockstar, Take-Two Interactive, announced that Rockstar Games purchased and acquired Angel Studios for a total of $28 million. Angel Studios was then renamed to Rockstar San Diego. Midnight Club 2 ended up hitting shelves on the 9th of April 2003 for the PlayStation 2, with an Xbox and PC port being released 2 months later. Despite the game being a sequel, the plot has little to do with the story of the first title. Around the world, a group of mysterious racers, called the Midnight Club, race for pride, power, and glory. Running through red lights, terrorizing pedestrians, and running from the police is as ordinary as walking the dog for the Midnight Club. You start off in Los Angeles with a not-so-fast compact car. You learn of the Midnight Club, and much like the previous game, you're interested in joining. In order to get invited to the club, you would have to beat the introductory character, Moses.
Look at this little shrimp. Where does he think he's kidding, posing like that? Think he can race me in that car? Still, I must try to be nice, yo. Hey, bro, follow me.
Whilst he's seen as an opponent to the player at first, Moses actually turns into a supporting character later on into the storyline. Now, this would be the first instance of some sort of narrative being built around the player, rather than every unique person being a rival or another racer. Tearing through the city and winning every race in between, you're directed to the Los Angeles champ, Dice. He is your typical tough guy who always wants to keep his clean rep on the streets.
Another rookie looking for a title shot, trying to take what's mine. He might have some juice, but I'm gonna drop some knowledge on this fool.
Careful, I got a reputation.
After beating him, you head over to Paris, where you'll eventually challenge the Paris champ, Parfait, or Perfect in French if you prefer. A former supermodel who is pretty insecure from the inside, but shows a lot of vanity from the outside.
I was crowned the Belle de l'année. Any man in the world used to be mine. Abruti, you are not even close to being good enough.
Beating her opens the gates to the game's final area, Tokyo. After meeting some of Tokyo's finest racers, you get to challenge the Tokyo champion, Makoto, a very successful and wealthy businessman.
The shame is almost unbearable. Take the car. You think you're real clever, I imagine.
After beating Makoto, you get to face the world champion, Savo, a brutish man of Slavic descent claiming to have died twice.
I've died twice before and I still breathe. This is sort of the same. Okay, maybe you win and relieve me of this burden to Los Angeles.
If the player is cunning and skilled, you get crowned as the world champion. Midnight Club 2 would go on to feature 29 race vehicles and 3 other non-race vehicles. Although the game features a shorter vehicle list, vehicle designs would see an overhaul from the first title to contrast this. Real-world counterparts of vehicles are also a lot more easier to identify, with examples like the RSMC-15 being based off a Nissan 350Z. The Moto Prego's real-world counterpart being the Porsche 911 GT3, and the Knight clearly resembling a Mitsubishi Lancer Evo 7. The game, however, has a totally new and pretty cool thing when it comes to vehicles. See, Midnight Club 2 was the first Midnight Club game to feature motorcycles, which would become a staple of the Midnight Club series. The bikes are very useful and, quite frankly, are the fastest vehicles in the game. Although the speed of the bike might be a little too overwhelming for some and they are very sensitive, one small bump could send you flying depending on how fast you're going, but they were a high-risk, high-reward vehicle, and they also changed the gameplay into a game of Frogger whilst in traffic and made riding incredibly testing and intense. In order to turn the bike at high speed, the game would make use of weight transfer. As the name would imply, instead of just turning, the driver would use his full weight to steer in whatever direction the bike is supposed to turn. This technique is basically essential if you want to win with any race on the bike. By doing a wheelie on the bike with weight transfer, you can also gain top speed quicker, whilst if you duck down on the bike using weight transfer, you can increase its top speed. The game also makes use of a ton of other new driving techniques not seen in the first game. These are slipstream. Tailgating the AI will reduce the air resistance in front of the player's car, giving the player a pretty significant advantage. In Midnight Club 2, if you tailgate long enough, a slipstream meter will fill up and supply the player with a quick boost. In air movement. By pressing the button used for weight transfer, you're able to move your car in the air for a better landing. Burnouts. If you time a burnout right at the start of a race, you'll be able to accelerate a bit better than normal. You can also use this to spin the car around after a crash. And finally, two-wheel driving. If you want to drive through those tight gaps or heavy heaps of traffic a lot easier, then the use of weight transfer on two wheels might just help you. The handling of Midnight Club 2 was also modified and improved extensively from the first game. All these changes in general made the racing experience far more high-octane and intense. But with that came far more challenge. Each vehicle in Midnight Club 2 is tuned differently to about 80 different parameters. These would include the basics like acceleration, top speed, transmission, drivetrain suspension, tire grip, and mass. However, there are also more sophisticated yet essential parameters like friction, downforce, and drag that play a huge role in making Midnight Club 2's physics feel fun, fast, and responsive. While Midnight Club Street Racing's twist to the action was the heavy use of shortcuts and several routes to win races, it definitely wasn't as reinforced as it was in Midnight Club 2. See, for this game, it is basically mandatory to use shortcuts in most races in order to win. These shortcuts include stuff like sewers, underground tunnels, huge jumps, plowing through buildings, and tons of other cool shortcuts to use to win races. The racing in Midnight Club Street Racing did offer some challenge, but that was mostly because of the speed of the AI. In Midnight Club 2, you have a lot more to be worried about. Gas stations and pumps are placed in really inconvenient spots that you might accidentally hit if you aren't careful enough. Some races also have the traffic scripted to do certain maneuvers that, in most instances, negatively affect the player. For instance, at the end of this race, a tanker truck will try to hit you just before the finish line. A semi-truck shows up in the middle of this race here. In this circumstance, you really have no other choice than to drive under its trailer if you want a chance at winning. Unless, of course, if the AI isn't being very smart. You see my tires smoke, you know how I do, it's the Midnight Club too. Arcade Mode makes a welcome return from the first Midnight Club, with it featuring all modes from the initial title, along with a few new ones to add to the roster. These include a feature to replay the events from the Career Mode. You can select events from all characters and either improve a top score in a lap, or just replay your favorite races from the Career. Capture the Flag makes a welcome return from the first game, with a new twist, power-ups. There are now power-ups you can use against your opponents to assure that you stay on top of the leaderboard. Another additional mode to add to the list would be Detonate. It is similar to Capture the Flag in flavor, but it has its differences. A bomb will spawn on the map, and someone has to collect and bring it to the detonation site to detonate it. However, you are not the only person looking to detonate the bomb, and when an opponent crashes into you, you have to chase after it again. Whoever detonates the bomb three times first wins. This game also features a race editor, an idea that was actually brought up during development for the first game, but was canned due to time constraints. This way, players can design their own races, which can be played in single player and multiplayer. Did I just say multiplayer? Of course I just said multiplayer, because Midnight Club 2 is the first Midnight Club game to feature online multiplayer, which was powered by GameSpy's servers. The official game servers shut down in May of 2014, but it is still very much playable through LAN, with the help of third-party apps like Tungle and Evolve. The soundtrack of Midnight Club 2 offers a bit more variety from the drum and bass only soundtrack we heard from the first game. Although there really isn't that much variety, as the rest of the soundtrack's just filled with 2000s trance and electronic music. But, however, the soundtrack this time also features some rap and house tracks in between those, with the entire soundtrack consisting of 38 songs from artists such as Felix de Housecat, Adolf Aguilar, Daft Punk, Art of Trance, and tons of other artists. Upon release, Midnight Club 2 received positive reviews from most critics and managed to sell even more than the first game. Rockstar San Diego realized just how much potential Midnight Club had, and quickly started working on the third installment, with only one goal in mind: creating the largest and most fun arcade racer ever released on 6th-gen platforms. After the rather mild successful release of Midnight Club 2, more racing games in the vein of Midnight Club's underground street racing action started being released, meaning Rockstar had received some stiff competition, primarily being from Electronic Arts, or EA. The primary example of this is Need for Speed Underground, a game released only 7 months after the release of Midnight Club 2. Now, a game of that scale could not be developed within that time period, so it can be argued that Rockstar Games jumped on the underground street racing bandwagon first, making them the pioneer of the genre. However, the primary differences between the two, both Midnight Club 2 and Need for Speed Underground, was the addition of customization, a feature that would be praised and sought after for every following racing game after that. Underground would prove to be immensely successful, with the game selling three times as many copies as what the entirety of the Midnight Club franchise had sold at the time. EA Black Box decided to pour some more salt on the wound when they released the sequel to the game a year later, which ended up selling roughly the same figures as Underground 1 had, meaning both games in total had sold at least over 20 million copies alone. Due to the huge success of Need for Speed, Midnight Club was kind of being placed on the back burner. People were just preferring the hip-hop-centered style the Need for Speed games had, instead of the Matrix trance digital feel of the Midnight Club titles. However, while everybody had their eyes set on Need for Speed, Rockstar San Diego were revving up to release their finest work yet. Midnight Club was about to go mainstream. Now, Midnight Club 2, whilst improving on the Midnight Club formula established through the first game, and also adding larger variety to the car list, world locations, and character design, they both heavily relied on the fast-paced racing and utilization of the world for its core gameplay. This would be turned on its head for the third iteration of the game. Rockstar wanted to go all out and shake up the entire formula with the third installment. Whilst Midnight Club 1 and 2 both had this overly underground style, Rockstar wanted to take a totally different route in terms of style and car culture for the third game. They wanted it to be far more mainstream, with the game having a heavy influence on hip-hop car culture. It was evident in how car culture was shaping throughout this time period, as the focus began to shift from the importuner scene to a larger variety of vehicles to be incorporated within the culture. The underground racing vibe would be revived to include far more mainstream vehicles and appeal to a larger demographic than just the Japanese car clubs. This can be demonstrated before the release of Midnight Club 3, with Underground 2's usage of muscle cars like the Mustang and the SUVs. The reaction to this resulted in Rockstar teaming up with Dub, a car magazine who documented and glamorized the sport of creating eccentric looks for rather expensive sedans and SUVs. Dub would tangle with Chrysler, Mercedes-Benz, Cadillac, Bentley, Audi, and would also work with celebrities to bling out their Lamborghinis, Ferraris, and Bugattis. While car taste is subjective, the rapper lifestyle really appealed to the look of the rims larger than 23 inches, with extremely low-profile tires lowered to the ground as far as it can go, and these exotic whites and blacks and greys in the metallic paints. This unique interpretation of car culture and the appeal of the rapper-esque vehicles would be what drew Rockstar to begin negotiations, finding Dub to have a unique take on car customization and thought no other magazine came close to capturing US car culture like Dub did. Developers knew that to have a modification-focused racing game true to what was actually happening in the scene at the time, and not just derivative of the Fast and Furious, they had to team up with Dub. Dub was very involved throughout the development of Midnight Club 3, informing Rockstar on what cars, aftermarket parts, and music to license to capture that mainstream feel. To quote, "When they predicted for us over a year ahead of time what cars would be hot by the time Midnight Club 3 released, they were right 9 times out of 10. Without Dub, our game wouldn't be near as authentic or expansive." In previous Midnight Club installments, Rockstar San Diego had never made use of real-world vehicles due to skepticism of license holders in regards to police and car damage, and they did not want to compromise on that. Along with that was the fact that Rockstar would rather express their creative freedom by designing and modeling their own vehicles, rather than spending millions of dollars on licensing vehicles. In order to work with Dub and maintain that authentic car crafting aesthetic they were striving for, they had to enlist real-world vehicles and aftermarket brands. Midnight Club 3 was set on having the longest and largest list of real-world vehicles in a street racing game, with the game's car list racking up to over 60 real-world vehicles, making the car list twice as long when compared to Underground 2. The variety was rich, ranging from tuners to SUVs, sports bikes, choppers, lowriders, exotics, luxuries, and muscle cars. The game would also feature expansive customization, from the basic visual aftermarket parts, including kits and wings, to putting neon on your vehicle, changing your license plate numbers, adding vinyls, ride height, and a lot more. The game was designed to outdo Underground 2 in its customization. For example, EA had ported the neon from Underground 1, whilst Midnight Club would introduce an RGB slider for neon color, as well as variable flashing speed for the underglow. Now, since Rockstar wanted to capture the feel of US tuner and car culture, it was decided upon that all areas of Midnight Club 3 would take place in the three cities most important to American street racing. These being San Diego. It was chosen because of it being the birthplace of early 90s tuner culture that made street racing quite popular, and it was also the area the game's studio was located in. Atlanta, the place where the most outrageous customizations were being created, especially for SUVs, luxury sedans, and the lowriders. And finally, Detroit, the birthplace of the automobile and where America's love for cars originated from. All three cities were planned to be roughly the same size as the second game's areas, and again feature its own landmarks and details, such as Georgia State Capitol, Michigan Central Station, the San Diego Zoo, and far more. In the morning of May 6, 2004, Rockstar announced it would partner up with the aforementioned Dub magazine to release Midnight Club 3, Dub Edition, later into the year, with the first trailer being released in September of the same year. It was originally slated for a January 2005 release, however was delayed, with the game finally being released on the 11th of April 2005 for the PlayStation 2 and the Xbox. Midnight Club 3 continues its tradition of starting off as a rookie street racer wanting to make a name for himself in the street racing scene. With that, you get sent off to San Diego by your acquaintance Baby to the American Royalty Car Club member Oscar, who owns his own tuner garage, 619 Customs.
I worked the engine with a new air intake, turbo, headers, and exhaust system. Then I dropped her, tightened up the suspension, and added a sway bar for less body roll. Oh, and I upgraded the brakes. And now she's riding on a set of 20-inch shoes. What are you talking about the money for? Do you understand the work that goes into this? The love? You're lost, fool. Hey, I gotta go. So you're Baby's boy, huh? The one he says is into cars. Cool.
He teaches you the ropes and lets you know all about the local races in the area. After challenging all characters in a 3-race series and beating all of the tournaments in San Diego, you get sent off to the largest area in the game, Atlanta. Oscar hooks you up with the car mechanic and owner of Tuning Garage, Apone Team Racing, Apone.
You know, once you think you got everything right, sit back, take a look, realize that it's all wrong, and then you gotta start all over again. That's why we do what we do. Ain't never love for the dubs, shawty.
After beating the races in Atlanta, you unlock the game's final location, Detroit, where you'll meet Vince, another good friend of Oscar, who happens to also be a car mechanic and owns his own car garage named Vince's.
You like this car? Yeah, she is beautiful, ain't she? She's the prize for whichever car club turns out the best street racer. I took her for a test drive. She is fast. Damn fast. Anyway, I gotta get back to work. Finish up the tune-up. If you need anything, give me a holler. And if there's any races, I'll let you know.
After beating all the local races again in Detroit, you get invited to a series of races where you'll have to beat all of the characters you've previously raced in a 2-race series, and that spans over all 3 of the game's areas. After beating these races, you will get titled the US Champion. While Midnight Club 2 was heavily character and story influenced, Midnight Club 3 kinda shied away from that. The first 2 games would feature characters with far more dialogue, hence giving off an underground racing vibe where everybody knew everyone. In Midnight Club 1 and 2, characters comment about your driving performance, your position during a race, weather conditions, and taunts you during the race.
You are very bad driver. Too bad for you. Too good for me.
You think your brakes can handle the wet cement, Ese?
This feature would not make a return for the third installment. Midnight Club 3 opted to remove the 3D animated character cutscenes, and rather only utilize 3D cutscenes for the dialogue between the player and the mechanic of the given area. These were a quirk of Midnight Club 2 that has, unsurprisingly, dated the game to the early 2000s, but it has given it a charm that now only Midnight Club 2 has. The only personality that Midnight Club 3 race characters really have left is their name, their ride, and the short description that either Baby or Oscar gives them.
Nice to see a 78, man. You gotta win this thing. That car is a classic, and the guy Carlos driving it is a chump. You wanna watch out for this girl, Vanessa. She's a real man-hater, homie.
The only characters in Midnight Club 3 that have any real kind of dialogue are the various car mechanics you see throughout the game's campaign, along with the unseen Baby, who acts as the game's narrator.
Yeah, homie. I'm impressed.
Here's a fun fact, the voice actor for Baby was popular hip-hop artist Birdman, whose nickname was also Baby. He has 3 of his own songs in the game's soundtrack as well. For the first Midnight Club game with licensed vehicles, Rockstar went for not only quality, but quantity as well. It is very plausible to say that Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition has one of the biggest licensed car lists to feature in a street racing game, with this feat only being rivaled by Tokyo Extreme Race's most recent titles, and some of the other examples being Forza Horizon and Test Drive Unlimited games. The game features 64 vehicles in total from manufacturers such as Nissan, Lotus, Lexus, Aprilia, Mercedes-Benz, Celine, Pontiac, Cadillac, and far more. What is even more impressive, other than the game's expansive amount of vehicles, is the amount of bodywork and freedom of customization that is allowed on most of these vehicles. You can customize bumpers, grills, spoilers, rear lights, side skirts, hoods, rims, neon. You can customize the color of your nitrous purge, the color of your HUD, the height of the vehicle, add hydraulics, add vinyls, and that still doesn't cover the amount of customizability that there are to all 64 vehicles in the game. Although, not every vehicle had the same amount of customization features, and this is mainly applying to the exotics, which barely feature any customization, which might have something to do with the licensing. Physics-wise, Midnight Club 3 retains the base physics engine of the previous installment, but steps it up a notch in terms of speed and realism. Midnight Club 3's vehicles have a lot more weight applied to them, and generally feel a lot more natural and realistic, although they are still ridiculously fast. Bikes are still extremely fast, but they're definitely a lot more balance in them than there was in 2. Midnight Club 2's physics engine was almost reworked from scratch, but Midnight Club 3 merely is just an improved library of Midnight Club 2. The third installment would also introduce a handling tuning mode where you can set the drift factor, traction, and friction bias for the vehicle. This will make drifting a lot more fun. The addition of licensed vehicles would not only mean less heavy damage models like from the first two games, but also would mean that running over pedestrians would be removed as well. There are four types of events in the Midnight Club 3 career mode. Tournaments and three other types of races. Tournaments will progress you through the game and show up frequently throughout the game's single player. Tournaments are a series of races, mostly around three, and the person who does the best during these series will win a prize. These races do have a twist to them, however, as you cannot back out of a tournament. You cannot restart a specific race during the tournament, and you have to complete them all in one go, making these events testing and very intense. Next up on our list is car club races. All of the characters in the game are members of their own car club. After beating a character, you might just get invited to join and race with them in that specific club. Each club is restricted to one of seven car types in the game. These clubs in question being the American Royalty Car Club, restricted to only muscle cars. The Unbeatable Street Races, tuners only. The Choppers of America Bike Club, which is restricted to just choppers. Big Players, for SUVs only. Luxury Rollers Car Club, only for luxury vehicles. By invitation only, restricted to the exotic vehicles of the game. And finally, the Original Riders, where only sport bikes are allowed. Each car club has a series of five races in each of the game's locations. After beating three of the races in a club, you'll unlock what is called a special ability for each car of that specific car class, which is a new feature for Midnight Club 3. We'll get into a lot more detail with that a little later on. And finally, the most simple event in the game, City Races. These show up as red dots on your map and are not really as important to the game's progression or 100% completion. These races only exist as a way to make money and practice your driving skills. All of the race types from the previous Midnight Club games make a welcome return, along with a totally new mode called Autocross. While you'll see this type of race only three times during the career mode, it is pretty cool. Basically, in Autocross, instead of just racing in the open, you are enclosed into a racetrack. This mode really tests your cornering skills, and at first tries can be pretty difficult if you don't have the right car or skill. In the career mode, these events show up only during tournaments. You get a series of three laps and a time limit. Let's say you're too late on the first lap, then you basically have two more laps to be able to redeem yourself and you win. There is another version of this event only available in the arcade mode called Track. They're basically just autocross events, but they've also got AI instead of a timer. To no one's surprise, Arcade Mode once again returns from the previous titles, with it featuring classic modes such as Capture the Flag, Cruise, Ordered Races, and more modes from the previous Midnight Clubs. This time, Arcade Mode features all new fun and innovative game modes to be played when bored of the campaign, and are all available in the split-screen mode with your friends. These new modes are the aforementioned Track Mode, Paint, and Frenzy. Paint would replace the Detonate mode from the previous game. In Paint, there are several checkpoints scattered across the map. When a vehicle crosses through that checkpoint, it will become painted in a color assigned to that vehicle, even if another vehicle has already painted it. The first person to color a predetermined amount of checkpoints in their color, or to have the most checkpoints colored at the end of the time limit, wins. In Frenzy, the objective is to score points by dodging as many vehicles as possible while hitting a never-ending series of checkpoints to keep the timer from running out or to get enough points. The race starts with an automatic burst of nitrous, with another burst firing off every 15 seconds, and your vehicle accelerating throughout the race until it reaches top speed. To make things even tougher, the vehicle's brakes and special abilities have been disabled. The race ends if the timer runs out, or if you get enough points. The race editor makes a welcome return, and comes back with an improved formula. Whilst in Midnight Club 2 you were restricted to a linear menu where you could only set checkpoints on intersections, Midnight Club 3 features an in-game race editor that lets you set checkpoints wherever you'd like. This will allow players to create more innovative races that can be played during the single player, multiplayer, and the online. Speaking of which, 8-player online multiplayer returns from the second game. It is mostly the same as the game's previous online mode, with a lot of improvements such as host migration, socialization, and asynchronous join. Racing and team drifting is still tons of fun today. The official servers that were powered by GameSpy shut down in 2014, along with Midnight Club 2 servers and a slew of other games. Luckily, Midnight Club 3 was one of the few racing games to feature LAN, meaning that it was still able to be played through Evolve on the PlayStation 2 emulator. It alternatively can also be played on a real PS2 by using a custom DNS server and GameSpy account. Now, let's talk about the special abilities. These are the mild power-ups that would give the player a significant advantage during the races. However, they aren't infinite and they aren't just handed over to you immediately. Each special ability has their own way of refilling as well. There are three special abilities available in the game, and these are... Zone. With this ability, you can slow down time whilst gaining more control over your car, which can greatly help with taking corners at high speeds or quickly to avoid any traffic that might be in your way. It's basically just bullet time for your car. You can refill a shot of zone by driving clean at high speeds for a certain amount of time. This special ability is restricted to only the tuners, exotics, and sports bikes. Aggro. Through this ability, you're able to smash through traffic and races as if they were nothing. Pretty helpful in knocking out any of the competition that's in front of you. You refill aggro by, ironically enough, hitting vehicles and objects in front of you, such as lampposts or rubbish bins. This ability is restricted to the heavyweight vehicles of the game, and also the luxury rides. And finally, roar. By activating Roar, you produce a wave that scatters away any races or traffic that might be close by. You refill Roar by power sliding and drifting. Now, Roar is only available to be used with the muscle cars and choppers. The idea of collectibles from the first game, whilst absent from the second, returns in Midnight Club 3. Each city has a set of 12 Rockstar collectibles. These are basically just floating Rockstar logos that are scattered around in areas of the map you wouldn't ever think to look. These logos can only be found and collected during free roam and not during events or arcade mode. There are a set of 36 in total, with each 12 of them that you collect, you win a prize. Collecting these logos are completely necessary for 100% completion. 1, 2, 3, you don't really wanna fuck with me. Get in the way, you could get yourself shot. Fuck the cops, you on my block, fucking with a gangster nigga. House real big, cars real big, belly real big, everything real big. Rims real big, pockets real big, rings real big. Let me tell you how I live. Like that, buy that, 24s ride that. Ladies, gentlemen, gangsters, pimps, mamas, daddies, stunners, shiners. Rich snitch, I'm a real big time. Midnight Club 2 only featured 38 musical tracks from a meager selection of hip-hop and a large section of trance. There at least was more variety than the soundtrack of the first game, but it's still very linear when you compare it. This is the absolute opposite when it comes to the soundtrack of Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition. Midnight Club 3's music selection now really does feature something for everybody. A bit of rock, bit of hip-hop, bit of electronic, hell, there's even some dancehall and some reggae music. It is truly a very stylish and expansive soundtrack filled with tons of variety. Rockstar started out with around a 1,000 song wish list. During the course of the game's development, however, this was put down to about a whopping 99 songs. Now, as a quick comparison, Need for Speed Most Wanted, a game released 7 months after Midnight Club 3, only featured 26. Midnight Club 3 would go on to feature the biggest licensed soundtrack in a street racing game at the time, and was one of the biggest licensed soundtracks in any racing game, period. Many popular and mainstream artists are featured, appearances from bands such as Nine Inch Nails, Queens of the Stone Age, Ash, dancehall acts like Beanie Man, Sean Paul, Mr. Vegas, and with the help from Dub, they got the hottest hip-hop stars at the time to make an appearance on the soundtrack, such as Twista, Fabolous, Fat Joe, Petty Pablo, and T.I. The Xbox version of the game also features a custom soundtrack feature, in case you ever get bored of the original soundtrack. In order to promote the game, Rockstar, in conjunction with Atlantic Records, published a CD titled Joint Chiefs and Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition, Custom Mix for Your Whip, which featured a selection of 13 songs, some that were featured in the release of the game. At E3 2003, Sony announced it would be working on a powerful handheld device that would be released in the following year. During next year's E3, the PlayStation Portable, or PSP, was announced, which would be more powerful than an original PlayStation, a very impressive feat for a handheld. Many gaming studios were looking to develop games for this new system, and Rockstar were also looking to jump on this bandwagon. Rockstar knew that it had to acquire a studio that was experienced with developing games for handheld titles, and it would look no further than Mobius Entertainment, the people who created the positively received Game Boy Advance version of the original Max Payne, which is another game published by Rockstar. In April of 2004, Mobius Entertainment would be acquired by Take-Two Interactive as a result of this, and it would become part of the Rockstar tree. Mobius Entertainment was then renamed to Rockstar Leeds. Rockstar Games had leads working on several new titles for the PlayStation Portable, the most notable being Grand Theft Auto: Liberty City Stories, a handheld version of the critically acclaimed Grand Theft Auto. This would end up being the best-selling game for the PSP, the success of this title being followed with a sequel the next year. However, GTA for the PSP was far from the only project that Leeds were busy with. The first name in street racing was about to come to handhelds. A month after the initial console release of Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition, a PSP port was announced, as Rockstar Leeds being the lead developer. It was announced it would harbour the features from the console release and then cram them into a small handheld system, along with new exclusive PSP features. Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition on the PSP ended up being released on June 27, 2005, and September 1st in North America and Europe, respectively. It is a marvel of video game technology, as Rockstar Leeds really managed to take the PS2 version and made it playable on a small on-the-go handheld in 2005. Really, everything from the console is actually on there. Only things are far more different in an obvious graphical downgrade and less traffic roaming around. But other than that, it is really Midnight Club 3 that we saw on the original consoles, like on the PS2 and Xbox, but on a handheld in your hand. Along with that, it also has wireless multiplayer with support for up to 6 players. While it is an extremely impressive feat that this port happened, it is brought down by several problems. Midnight Club 3 on the PSP has awful loading times, sometimes upward of around 70 to 80 seconds. Imagine watching a looping animation of a circle for a whole minute to start one of hundreds of races in a game. That is basically what Midnight Club 3 on the PSP is like. Along with that is an awful frame rate. This game could sometimes drop around 10 to 15 frames a second, depending on how much was going on the screen. It received average to mediocre reviews, largely due to these major issues. All in all, it was impressive to have a bootable version of Midnight Club 3 on a handheld device, but Leeds focused on getting all of the console features onto the handheld, which is what caused it to sacrifice a lot of necessary things. Despite this, however, the PSP version of Midnight Club 3 would end up being the best-selling version of the game. Rockstar San Diego was still far from done with Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition, and they eventually started working on re-releasing the game with tons of new features and improvements over the first release. On February 3rd, 2006, Rockstar Games announced Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition Remix, which would hit shelves in March of 2006. To quote, "We are thrilled with the response Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition received, and we wanted to be able to give something extra to the fans who have supported the series throughout the years. We are giving them access to all new cars, a new city, and new music with Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition Remix, along with all of the speed and style that defined the series." It would also be announced that this re-release would feature save game transfer from the original title to the re-release, thus saving the player from starting all over again. Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition Remix was eventually released on March 13 and March 15 for the PlayStation 2 and Xbox in North America and Europe respectively. Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition Remix has tons of new features over the original: 24 new vehicles, 25 new songs from musical acts such as The Game, Block Party, Stereophonics, Damian Marley, among others. An entirely new area and career mode that takes place in Tokyo, dubbed the Tokyo Challenge, was also added as well. Tokyo and Midnight Club 3 would end up being ported from Midnight Club 2, with it featuring a lot of new changes that would make Midnight Club 3's Tokyo feel different from the original Tokyo seen in the second installment. In the new Tokyo Challenge career mode, you find yourself at the Japanese Speedway Garage, a garage that seems to only be inhabited by car mechanics Tomoyo and Toshi, who mostly scream at each other when they are under the assumption the player isn't there.
You're fired! Don't come back!
Yeah.
Hey, cool, friend. That Toshi, he's useless. Good riddance. Now, I get real guys in here, not some girl. I could have beaten him up. I know karate. I know a lot of things.
Tomoya would show you how things work in Tokyo, handing out useful tips and lets you know of any important events going on in the city, basically becoming the game's narrator when in Tokyo. Progression is pretty different in Tokyo than the progression from the US areas, where in the US, city races don't progress you through the career in the States, with character races bringing you to the end credits. In Tokyo, city races will help you unlock tournaments. While in the States there were no restrictions to entering tournaments, in Tokyo, each tournament is restricted to either a specific car class or vehicle type.
Make sure you show up in the right vehicle, or they won't let you drive, okay? Cool.
After beating a certain amount of tournaments, you get invited to race in the Imperial Palace Tournament. Upon beating this, you get a pat on the back from Tomoya, technically become the Tokyo champion, and win a Pagani Zonda, one of the fastest cars in the game.
But, hey, cool man, you're the big man now. You bring respect to me, to the Speedway name. You beat everyone in Tokyo. Respect, friend. Now you done. You can keep racing, but only for money, you know? You got all the juice you need now, friend. Cool. Excuse me.
Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition Remix would serve as the definitive version of Midnight Club 3. All in all, Midnight Club 3 was stylish, expansive, modern, fun, and memorable. It really was one of the best racing games of its time, and is still greatly remembered to this day as setting the bar for street racing games. Midnight Club ended up being Rockstar Games' second most successful IP, after the release of the third installment, it only being behind Grand Theft Auto. However, Rockstar San Diego wasn't about to give up. You see, Midnight Club would go through a renovation bigger than anyone would ever expect. Knock knock, open up the door, the 7th gen consoles were arriving. Let's just take a couple of steps back for a moment. In August of 2004, well-known video game publisher Electronic Arts bought video game studio Criterion Games, the people behind the well-received Burnout arcade racer titles. This would mean that all of Criterion's assets would be in the hands of EA. But why is this relevant to Rockstar Games, you may ask? Well, Criterion were also the people behind one of the most powerful video game engines of the 6th gen era, RenderWare. This engine was used in over 100 games, including some of Rockstar's biggest hits. For example, Grand Theft Auto 3 up until San Andreas, Bully, and Manhunt as well. The acquisition of Criterion Games meant EA would have full control and rights over the RenderWare brand and engine, and could, of course, pick favorites and choose who to allocate it to. This would cause a lot of problems for Rockstar Games, and EA was one of Take-Two's rival publishers. It would simply be too risky for Rockstar to keep using an engine owned by a rival publisher. And if that wasn't enough, they'd then have to pay royalties for every GTA game sold that was made with RenderWare. This would leave Rockstar with two options. Either search for a new and already existing video game engine which would be powerful enough for Rockstar to utilize, or create a totally new video game engine proprietary to Rockstar that would allow them to make Rockstar's biggest dreams and visions for the next generation become a reality. Now, Rockstar had always gone the extra mile and decided to pick the latter option. They decided creating a whole new engine for the upcoming generation of consoles would be the best strategy. So who else to go to than Rockstar San Diego, the 3D and physics fanatics? They had created another video game engine prior to starting the work on this one, the Angel Game Engine, which was used to power the Midnight Club games and all other projects Rockstar San Diego had developed at the time. Rockstar San Diego had devised a team comprised of the studio's most talented people in order to work on this new engine, which would be based off Rockstar San Diego's previous engine and would eventually adopt the name Rockstar Advanced Game Engine, shortened to RAGE. The first game released with the RAGE engine was peculiar to say the least. Rockstar presents Table Tennis in May 23rd of 2006. This game would merely just serve as a tech demo for this all-new and powerful game engine, although Rockstar kind of wanted to make a table tennis game for the longest time up until then for some peculiar reason. Rockstar Table Tennis would be a sign of what was to come from Rockstar during this new era of gaming. Now, there were several games that were under development using RAGE. The Old West Project, which would later be released as Red Dead Redemption in 2010, Agent, an unreleased shooter game, Rockstar North's Grand Theft Auto IV, and a new Midnight Club installment, codenamed Midnight Club 4. This new installment would take the series to a whole new level and bring Midnight Club to a whole new era of gaming. With the dawn of the powerful 7th gen consoles looming around the corner, Rockstar felt that it would be cool to have a game centered around one massive and detailed location. This location would shape the entire feel of the game and have the biggest role in this new Midnight Club. In previous games, there were several locations available for the player to drive through, and of course cause havoc in. Whilst it was cool to have several unique locations to explore, they could sometimes feel a little bit underwhelming, small, or not as detailed. Midnight Club was always seen as average when it came to graphical details and features. Rockstar knew this and, with the new hardware they were given, decided to use RAGE to its fullest potential to create a graphically impressive game, with the most detailed world seen in a racing game up until that point. Now, this was quite an ambitious goal, due to it having to go up against EA's Need for Speed Carbon, their next open world title, Undercover, Burnout Paradise, and Pimp My Ride for the Wii.
What's going down? Marcia, I'm here to pimp your ride, homegirl.
Yeah! I knew it! Oh my god, my ride's gonna get pimped! What?
Shit. But Rockstar San Diego decided that the new Midnight Club would return to Los Angeles. And this wouldn't be some port of LA we've seen in the second installment, oh no. Los Angeles this time will be bigger than all of Midnight Club 3 cities combined, and also be incredibly detailed. Rockstar were aiming at creating the most realistic depiction of LA ever seen in a video game. However, they of course couldn't do a road-to-road 100% accurate representation, as that would be too difficult and would make it not that great for a racing game. But they were trying to get LA as accurate as possible, whilst also optimizing the city for Midnight Club's signature fast-driving mayhem. A team of six flew from Rockstar's New York studio to San Diego to meet 20 artists and designers from Rockstar San Diego's office, scouting and photographing LA's nooks and crannies for months on end. In fact, the location would have such an importance in this new Midnight Club title, they just flat out named the entire game after it. Midnight Club Los Angeles was the chosen name for the fourth installment. Most of Los Angeles' most important landmarks would be featured, such as the Hollywood Film Studios, Santa Monica Pier, the Staples Center, the Chinese Theater, the Chateau Marmont, and tons more. During the start of the 7th gen era of gaming, it would become a popular trend amongst many games to try and get rid of loading screens, something that ruled over video games during the previous generation of systems. Rockstar San Diego would be one of them, and it would be one of their most important goals to eradicate loading times from LA to keep the action going. Loading screens would still technically remain in the game, but to mask them, the game heads to a bird's eye view of the world for a few seconds before starting an event. Rockstar always went a step forward and never backwards, so licensed vehicles were set to return and there would be more detail than ever this time, with a single vehicle containing 100,000 polygons. Now, if you remember earlier, we spoke about this and said that Midnight Club 2 had about 1 million polygons put into each city. A single vehicle in Midnight Club Los Angeles would pretty much be 1/10 of an entire in-game area, meaning that 10 vehicles literally would make up an entire location in a previous Midnight Club title. Now, not only was this quite telling of the hardware, but also the detail put into development. Vehicles would not only be detailed from the outside, however, but also from the inside. Rockstar San Diego had always wanted to put a cockpit view into their games ever since Midnight Club 3, but due to the hardware limitations of the consoles back then, it wasn't really seen as a priority and would not really become a thing. Thanks to the powerful new hardware, however, it was finally possible for Rockstar San Diego to include an actual cockpit view as one of their camera modes. Each car would have its own interior, and we're not just talking about copy and paste dashes here, no. Each car has its own unique gauges, steering wheel, and general look, and can also be customized with aftermarket parts, colors, and neon, but I'm getting ahead of myself. Because of the addition of cockpit view, it was evident that it was going to become a more daunting task to model vehicles, so it would eventually become inevitable that the new Midnight Club was going to feature less varied vehicles than the previous installment. Rockstar San Diego, however, was working on bringing in still an impressive list of 50 detailed vehicles, ranging from mostly luxuries, tuners, exotics, sports bikes, and muscle cars. All that would feature its own customization features, just like in 3. Dub would still have a rather large presence during this game's development, however not to the point where Rockstar would name the entire game after it. Dub would still help Rockstar with car part licenses and even have some of their own custom Dub vehicles in the game, which are basically just Dub customized versions of their vehicles. Midnight Club Los Angeles would be announced to the public in May of 2007, with an expected release date of early 2008 on the PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360. A first trailer was released and an in-game demo was shown at Games Convention and PAX that same year. Rockstar San Diego has always been the technology leader in delivering the ultimate racing experience, and with this game, they are looking to redefine the idea of a completely immersive racing game experience, both offline and online. The game would eventually be released worldwide on the 24th of October 2008 for the PS3 and Xbox 360. Yeah! Whilst the city itself can really be considered the main character of Midnight Club Los Angeles, the game's plot would also feature its own star. Midnight Club LA was the only title in the franchise to feature a story protagonist. In earlier games, the protagonist was you, the player behind the screen. However, Midnight Club would now incorporate narrative elements similar to the Grand Theft Auto titles, with the game having its own written main character and characters not just talking to the camera. However, Rockstar pulled a GTA 3 and decided not to give the main character a name, with him even being referred to as Player in the credits. He is sometimes nicknamed Marcus during the story, however, so we'll dub him as Marcus for the sake of the video. Marcus, voiced by American actor and American Idol candidate Matthew Metzger, is a small-time illegal street racer living in the East Coast. He gets word by his friend Tony that there is a serious street racing scene going down in the West, specifically Los Angeles. Tony sets Marcus up with the well-respected street racer Book, and they both agree to meet at a fast food joint as soon as Marcus arrives in LA. There you meet Book, along with his friends Nikolai and Trevor.
Nice car!
Thank you. What, so you Book?
So they say.
What?
Man, don't tell everyone.
Trust me, man, I won't.
Man, you're funny. You're like Tony. You're one of them funny East Coast guys, huh? You here to do stand-up?
No, are you?
Book doesn't need to stage. People laugh at him just walking down the street.
Whatever you say, Nikolai. Your girlfriend found me funny.
She did.
Ooh.
She was confused, wondering why you dressed like you're playing golf.
Cole! Yeah, shut up, y'all. Anyway, what you here for?
Race some cars, man.
What you mean, race some slow cars? It's a lot of kids hanging around down on the strip, right between Rodeo and Fairfax. Go race them. Then we'll talk.
Okay.
Good luck, homie.
When arriving, you get to choose between three broken and busted up cars, which are the Volkswagen Scirocco, Nissan 240SX, and the Volkswagen Golf GTI. However, Book wants to see what you're made of first and orders you to race against Henry, who drives a Datsun 280Z. After winning the race against Henry and showing Book that you can drive, he sets you up with well-respected private dealership owner Carol, who would hook you up with garages around the city to store, buy and sell, and also customize cars in. Book and Carol would then inform you of the new races and hand out tips to get you on your feet. The game's progression is split into three chapters: the Hills chapter, Beach chapter, and Downtown chapter. When you first arrive in Los Angeles, you begin your career by racing and meeting characters in the Hollywood Hills, with events slowly moving towards the other two regions as you get well acquainted with the game world. Races, of course, will not be restricted to only these areas, but most new races will be found in a location applied to whatever chapter you are in. So, let's say you're in the second chapter of the game, the so-called Beach chapter, then most new and important races will start in Santa Monica. If you're in Chapter 3, the Downtown chapter, most new races will be found in the downtown areas. Our main character, the aforementioned Marcus, is a very cocky and dry guy who always likes to act out as a comedian most of the time.
Lester, this is...
Yeah, we already met. He won a book, homie.
You've gotta be kidding me. I thought you weren't like that.
I'm not. I'm, just down here to get a tattoo.
Really?
Yeah. I was thinking try hard right here on my neck.
Very funny.
Other than that, there's really not much to say about his character or personality, as we don't really get to develop him or give him user-generated traits. He never reveals much about himself and doesn't really take a lot seriously. Hell, we don't even know his real name. This appears to be a blend of creating a protagonist for the player to identify with, whilst also maintaining the anonymity of the player, as seen in the previous games. However, to contrast this, your journey through LA is filled with a lot of faces. The most prominent are Annie, Hugo, Andrew, as well as Carol and Book. Book, the game's antagonist, who is voiced by singer and actor Martin McCoy, grew up in Beverly Hills and has been racing ever since his time in high school. He is wealthy and overconfident, but aids the protagonist through the first half of the game. He'll provide you with info on new events pretty much all of the time, along with some playful banter.
Hey, I hope this isn't a social call. I got enough friends.
You're all charm, Book. Trust me, I don't want to hang out. I want races.
Let's see what you can do against little old Nikolai. Go find him on the strip. He should be in a 1969 Camaro SS.
Thanks.
Carol, the game's deuteragonist, voiced by Saul Stein, is a car mechanic and owner of the successful private dealership Hollywood Auto. Carol hands out several tips to the player and sets the player up with vehicles and customization parts, along with new characters and races. He also personally challenges the player to a race whenever he's bored or whenever he wants to show off the speed of his new ride.
I'm bored. I have to be to call you.
How can you be bored? You're 45, work in a garage, and spend your free time racing kids half your age. You're living the dream.
And you're living in a dream. Listen, enough messing about. Time for a real challenge. Just me and you.
That's not what I call a challenge. But sure, I'm down.
Okay, come on, let's do this.
He also reminisced a lot about his time under communism.
I'm just doing what they wanted.
That's the problem with liberty. Where I'm from, people were told what to like. Oh, God, sometimes I think it's best for everyone. Aren't you two supposed to have some passionate romance? Huh? Aren't me and you supposed to get into some big fight? Huh? In this Hollywood? Huh? I spent the first 20 years of my life living under communism, learning how to live from the movies. Come on. Show me something!
You're drunk. Bye, guys. Have fun.
Annie, voiced by movie actor Nikki Snelson, is one of the first people you are introduced to during the game's storyline. She's an outgoing and charming lady, but can be snarky when she's in a competitive mood.
Listen, brah, will you just chill out?
Brah? What is wrong with you, Brian? You come from Ohio. And why don't you give me back my money, brah?
Whatever.
I'll show you whatever. I don't care how big your trust fund is. You are too old to still be this much of an idiot. You and your trendy idiot friend.
You knew the rules, Annie. Period.
I hope somebody dropped you on your head when you were a baby, Brian, because something better explain how you turned out.
Peace and love, Annie.
Hey, my friend of Carol, he said you might know some races.
Sure. You can race that doofus. He's rolling in money. He just ripped me off. He and his doofus friends hang out at the parking lot. You know, the one by the mall in Century City?
Okay.
They're annoying, but they're crazy. If you can beat them, then maybe we can race.
Spending most of her time in Santa Monica, she serves as the segue into the second chapter of the storyline. Hugo, voiced by actor Geraldo Rodriguez, is a rather dark, overconfident, and no-nonsense-looking guy at first glance. He runs a tight racing crew by young drivers who dominate the downtown racing scene. Hugo hangs out in an abandoned underground parking lot in downtown Los Angeles, which is where the player first meets him after Marcus was informed of Hugo by Book.
So, you're Book's homie?
Yeah, something like that. You Hugo?
Something like that. Listen, you even know what you're getting into down here?
Car racing, I hope.
Okay, big man. Go race my friend Miguel right here. He'll let me know if you can hang with us, not with Book and his little posse of ladies.
See, now I heard you were the man to race, Hugo.
That's cool, because I didn't hear that about you. And when I do, then we can talk.
However, upon beating him, you'll see his desperate side and realize he isn't the hotshot he says he is.
Good for you, but aren't you a little bit late?
Huh?
I already beat you.
You beat me driving my sister's car. That thing was messed up.
Yeah, something was messed up.
I got a Golf 32 now, I see.
Oh, really? Well, I hope it can drive for you.
Excuse me?
You're right, I'm sorry. You're the man, whatever.
Come on. Hey, don't be a punk. Give me a chance.
All right, let's go.
Just like Annie, he'll invite you to numerous races around the downtown area in several vehicles. And finally, Andrew. In the same fashion as Hugo, Book informs you of street racer Andrew and his friend Jin, who you can find at several car hangouts in downtown and in the hills. Andrew grew up helping at his uncle's garage in downtown Hollywood after school, and has been racing ever since he was 17. He's highly strong, but sees himself as unbeatable. You will do several car races first with Andrew. Upon beating him multiple times in a car, he'll then challenge you to motorcycle races around the hills.
Stupid friggin'.
Hey, relax, man.
Winning or losing doesn't matter in a piece of junk like this. Anyone can drive one.
Yeah, whatever you say.
For real. You think you're something special because you can press down a pedal? You think you're hard and fearless? Get on a bike, buddy! On a bike!
Okay.
Go get some practice and meet me in the hills. Then we'll see how tough you really are, buddy.
Wait, what, you think I need practice to beat you? I just saw you drive, man.
I'll take you on, buddy. Anytime.
Meeting Andrew would cause an unexpected turning point for the well-established friendship between Marcus and Book. Book had suggested to Marcus to team up in a race against Andrew and his friend Jin. Marcus decides to do the race, but things go south real quickly due to the police's efforts in shutting down the race. Whilst Marcus tries escaping the police, Book calls Marcus for help.
Five-O's all over us, man! Get out of here! Hey, you gotta help me out, man! I'm in some serious heat here!
Are you crazy? You're all over me too, man! What do you want me to do?
Have you forgotten what I've done for you? You'd be nothing without me! You owe me, man!
Look, I'd love to talk, but I gotta shake these fools! You're supposed to be the hotshot driver. Deal with it yourself.
I'm telling you, if you don't help me out now, it's over. We got him. Cut you off.
You're out of your mind, Book.
Suspect is going south on the 110 freeway, approaching the 5.
However, he obviously can't help due to the fact he has the cops on his tail as well. So Book eventually gets arrested by the police and is thrown in jail. He blames Marcus for him ending up in the slammer and sees his act as a sign of betrayal. After making bail, Book rises to city champ status, all the while cutting off contact with Marcus. Carol informs Marcus of Book spreading rumors about Marcus and informs him on where to find him, in a luxury penthouse in downtown LA.
There he is, Judas, the ex-apostle.
Marcus challenges him to a race in order to claim his title as the city champ. However, Book is not willing to give Marcus a chance unless he beats the champions of each of the game's three main areas, which are the Beaches champ, Leticia, the Downtown champ, Tommy, and the Hills champ, Leon. Upon beating these three races, you get to finally challenge Book and have a chance at taking his spot as the city champion.
Here he is, the challenger.
And here he is, the challenged.
Still a comedian. So driving, that's the real joke.
You'll remind me why we didn't end up hanging out more. Probably for the same reason none of these girls want to talk to you.
Hey, man, I don't really want to talk to you.
Trust me, the feeling is mutual. So can we just race and then get on with our lives?
Yeah, and I'm gonna send you back under whatever rock you came from.
Yeah, right.
If your skills and wits are about you, you will be crowned the city champion. But Carol calls and proposes a bold offer.
So who's the rookie now?
Sure, I guess congratulations are in order, but that's not why I'm calling. I've got a business proposition that you and your ego might be interested in. I'm looking for a partner.
A partner? I thought you hated me. Anyway, I'm kind of setting my sights higher than a chop shop business.
I don't want you to work there, man. I couldn't think of anything worse. No, you've made a name for yourself. People know you in L.A., and I want those people's business. Your reputation is the best kind of advertising I can get right now. I want you to spread the word, and in exchange, you get the choice of vehicles and parts. Whatever you want, whenever you want.
So I carry on racing, drop your name around town a few times, and get any car I want? There's gotta be a catch. You're not gonna make me wear a billboard, are you?
No, it's that simple. All you need is $1 million.
For a cool $1 million, Marcus gains the privilege of customizing and purchasing his vehicles for free. After a brief meeting at the chateau, and with $1 million, you seal the deal and the credits roll.
Welcome aboard! Well, now I want to tell you a little story.
The game is still far from over, and you still have a ton of unique events to do around the city, such as beating the champs for each car class, such as the Tuner Champ, or the Muscle Champ, for instance. However, making that transaction essentially ends the game's base story. In Midnight Club 3, barely any kind of character dialogue was featured, with race dialogue and taunts featuring in the first two installments, but being non-existent in the third game. The lack of communication to the player and personality when it came to Midnight Club 3 made the game feel a lot less engaging and failed to interact with the player on a personal level, like in Midnight Club 2 for instance. This hindered the personality of the third game. Rockstar San Diego must have been aware of this and took it upon themselves to have a go at some genuine world building through characters. There is now an abundance of faces and dialogue. Throughout races, opponents will comment on everything from jumps, to crashing, Marcus will even comment on his finishing position as well.
Okay. Yes. What's my name? Toad Switch. Number one, baby.
And he also does some really cool looking animations, such as him fist pumping or doing the horn sign when finishing a race, head banging or checking his mirrors when being idle, and so on. Whilst these features aren't capitalized on throughout the game's story, an inquisitive player will notice these small details. As mentioned before, licensed vehicles return from the previous installment. LA features smaller amounts of vehicles and vehicle classes than Midnight Club 3, but the game still spoils you for choice with 46 vehicles from Lamborghini, Nissan, Ducati, and Mercedes-Benz returning from Midnight Club 3, along with vehicles from manufacturers not seen in 3, these being Ford, Audi, Buick, and Aston Martin. There are some very nice inclusions to the car list, such as Mitsubishi's 3000 GT, the Pontiac Saltus, and the 1970 Dodge Challenger RT, just to name a few. Los Angeles is also the first Midnight Club to feature convertibles, and yes, you can actually slide the roof on and off, which is a very nice touch for a game from 2008. All vehicles are customizable this time, including aftermarket parts for the bikes and exotics, something that wasn't featured in Midnight Club 3. Your bumpers, rims, spoilers, front and rear lights, exhausts, license plates, side skirts, and neon can all still be customized here. Unfortunately, there really isn't that much variety or quantity of parts like there was in 3. While there are still tons of customizable parts, things like bumpers, spoilers, and other aftermarket parts, depending on which car or car class you picked, had at least 2 to 9 parts to choose from, on an average of about 20 in the previous installment. However, each type of aftermarket part for each vehicle only features 5 parts to choose from, meaning less variety when it comes to aftermarket customization, which is just a general shame. LA does feature new customization options such as wide bodies for each vehicle, being able to add scissor doors as corny as they are, adding intercoolers and interior customization where you can replace the steering wheel, add custom gauges, change the color of that gauge and the interior, replace the seats, add some neon inside as well. Despite the restrictions on external customization, these little features give back some sort of control over to the player, which is a nice compromise. Some of the customization options seen in Midnight Club 3 are also a lot more elaborate in LA, especially when it comes to the tires and rims. You're able to change the color of a specific parts on the wheels, such as the spokes, lips, and different paint types as well, such as brushed, chromatic, or painted colors. Change the tire profile, tire width from either specifically the front, the back, or both. Change the opacity of custom colored windows, and far more. However, the biggest addition to the customization is the all-new vinyl editor. You're now able to scale and move and rotate vinyls, which will allow for very innovative car designs. You can then optionally chuck that car onto the Rate My Ride service, but we'll get into that a little bit later on. Car damage extends to bumpers falling off some vehicles, scratches, and broken windows. If you're in a series of races, in the transition period between the race finishing and the next race starting, parts that may have fallen off or gotten too damaged will be replaced with grey replacement parts. Something that I haven't seen replicated in other games, and is a great feature for continuity. Whilst in previous games, gas stations were really only seen as a nuisance, and they still kind of are.
Listen, if you're gonna kill yourself, do it someplace else.
They now serve a purpose other than to just screw you over during races. If you stop at a gas pump, you'll be able to fully fix your vehicle or completely refill your nitrous. If you drive through a gas station during a race, you'll also refill a can of nitrous. However, do it at your own risk.
I don't like this!
As said before, Midnight Club Los Angeles is the first Midnight Club game to feature a cockpit view, which has stood the test of time and still looks fantastically detailed today. Intrinsic detail was paid attention to in the first-person department, with the game featuring full 900-degree steering lock, something you don't see in a lot of racing games, surprisingly. Also, an animation for reversing where the main character holds one hand flat on the steering wheel, along with some more subtle and natural mannerisms when driving. There are also some other small but nice details to the vehicles, such as lights fading in instead of immediately popping in, transmission whine when reversing, when looking back, the game will quickly and temporarily fade to black to give some sort of blinking eye effect. These and more show an intrinsic eye for detail, something Rockstar have always been renowned for, but it's just great to see that same care and love being put into Midnight Club. Special abilities also return from Midnight Club 3 and have been more or less overhauled to encourage flexibility and a more tangible use as a resource, rather than a commodity that needs to be cherished. In Midnight Club 3, special abilities were restricted to a specific vehicle type. Aggro for the luxuries and SUVs, Zone for the tuners and sports bikes, etc. However, in Midnight Club Los Angeles, you can apply any special ability to any car, so you can finally use aggro on that tuner now. A new special ability was also added, EMP, which shocks any nearby drivers and temporarily stalls them.
Is you crazy?
Whilst in Midnight Club 3, you could fill up as many as 4 special ability charges without restriction, in LA this is quite a different story. There are now several levels of special abilities, 3 in total, which you'll unlock by using a particular special ability for a certain amount of time. The level determines the amount of charge you can refill on a certain ability, and how fast they'll refill, along with how long you can use them for. In Midnight Club 3, each special ability refilled differently, but in this installment, all special abilities refill by driving at high speeds for a certain amount of time without crashing. You would expect that with an entirely new video game engine that they'd shake the physics up completely, but in reality, they'd design the physics in a way that'd be very similar to Midnight Club 3. However, the cars do feel very different. The infamous brake-to-slide element that was seen in previous games is now less exaggerated. You could even argue it's almost gone. It leans a bit closer to Simcade than Arcade this time around. Police return, but you'll also see them around in cruise mode now. In earlier Midnight Club games, police only showed up during races and not during free roam, and when they were scripted to do so. With a large city swarming with street races, they ought to take to the streets and stop you both in and out of races. In order to avoid a pursuit, it's rather elementary. You have to follow the rules of the road and not breach the law whilst driving. There is a meter in the HUD that indicates how close the police are to your vehicle. The more it beeps and flashes, the closer the cops are, and more of a chance you'll get busted if driving recklessly. Also, if you get fined, you will be able to do the coolest thing ever in a racing game.
None of you are catching me.
What are we looking for?
10-4 on that. I'm out on stop.
Didn't see that coming, did you?
He's trying to get away. Suspect is taking off.
Early into the game, this does get tense, but you'll eventually learn to avoid the police. They act as a mobile roadblock rather than a police force. But for the risk takers, you can always just get into a pursuit to gain some easy rep and experience. Just make sure that you don't get arrested.
Put your hands on your head! Driver, come out of your vehicle!
Not only do the police come after you if they see you breaking the law, they'll also search for you whenever you, say, drive through a park or a mall.
3103, request driver.
Copy that. 2 Adam 6, I'll take the call.
2 Adam 6, 10-4. Go ahead.
Easy pursuit.
Copy that.
The Popo don't show up a lot during races, but when they do, you'll have to escape them either during the race or after the race is finished, which is far better than having them despawn, like in previous installments. This could be Rockstar taking a page out of Black Box's book, as it plays out rather similarly to Need for Speed. Ease back for a trip on. Get my dog and in your bend this rockers. Previously, the practice of launching races was a very basic and straightforward mechanic. For this title, you'll have an entire mission log where you'll be doing unique events or racing unique characters, which makes the game feel a lot less repetitive than previous titles. This game contains 97 missions in total, and you unlock them by, well, completing other missions. You'll be notified if a new mission has been unlocked for you when either Book, Carol, or one of the other characters call you. Some examples of these missions you'll be seeing throughout the game are beat this guy in a 3-series race, beat up this person's car, win a certain amount of money doing wages, complete 10 freeway races, etc, etc. Car Club races from Midnight Club 3 are now replaced with mission objectives like beat 6 races in a muscle car, or beat 6 races in a luxury, and so on. With every new Midnight Club, there's always been some new and innovative race types, and this remains the same in Midnight Club Los Angeles, with Career Mode introducing all new event types. These being landmark races and red light races. Just what the title says, you have to race to a specific landmark or intersection in LA. Ah, but there's a catch. There are no checkpoints guiding you on where to go. You'll have to find the fastest route to the finish yourself. This pays homage to the Midnight Club's infamous unordered races, a terrific way to gain map knowledge more than anything. Time trials. Well, Midnight Club Los Angeles technically isn't the first Midnight Club to feature time trials. That title would of course go to the first two Midnight Club games. However, in LA it is an actual event type seen quite a lot throughout the main story. In Midnight Club 1 and 2, they can't really be seen as a dedicated event type, hell, they aren't even classified as a mode in arcade mode. Midnight Club Street Racing only features 2 time trial events as an extra in arcade mode, and in Midnight Club 2, time trials were only seen 3 times throughout the game's single player. In LA, you'll find several people hosting these time trials. There are 4 instances of time trials throughout the story, each containing 3 missions. If you finish the first mission of a time trial stage, you'll eventually be notified your time has been beaten. You'd then have to do the exact same time trial again, only now with an increasingly stricter time limit. After topping the time charts 3 times, you will unlock the vehicle you perform the time trial in. Wager and Pink Slip Races. Around Los Angeles, there are several car meets where fellow racers hang out. You can then race them for money or for their ride. Since it's a wager event, if you lose, you lose the money you bet on the race. If you're feeling particularly risky, Pink Slip Races make a return from the first Midnight Club to get your blood pumping, but with one key difference. See, Midnight Club didn't take your car away, but this time, it works like intended, so everything is on the line. Freeway races. As the name would imply, these are races that strictly take place on the freeway. You'll find several characters cruising through the interstate. By flashing your lights, the race will immediately start and you keep to the freeway until the finish. Delivery missions. These events have you deliver vehicles to Carol's clients under a time limit. Better yet, he wants these cars in top condition, so you will be penalized for any damage due to the vehicle. Focus and mastery of car control is essential for this event. Payback missions. Carol informs the player of clients that haven't paid him yet.
One of my customers ripped me off. He owes me $8,000. Suddenly his phone gets disconnected, if you know what I mean.
Sure.
Do me a favor. Take the car out front. It's old and heavy. Smash the hell out of his car. Then we'll see who wants to rip me off, eh?
Not me, that's for sure.
He thinks it's a good idea that these people be taught a lesson, so orders the player to take a Buick GNX and smash up the client's vehicle as revenge. Harmless fun and easy money. Aside from the whole mission structure, the game has a totally new progression system, made to mirror the trend of XP bars and progression emerging at the time. By winning events, or do things like lose the police, you'll earn rep. With rep, you'll be able to unlock new vehicles and parts, and be able to progress over onto several ranks. You start off with backseat driver rank, and you eventually try to work your way up to the final and ultimate rank, idle. Arcade mode is back, but unfortunately, there is just not much to say about it. They haven't added any new cool modes like the previous games have, and have actually removed classic modes like Capture the Flag, amongst others. In order to contrast the removal of these modes, and to spice up the single player a bit, Rockstar have included a mode specifically made for the completionists out there. This being, Goal Attack. Rockstar made a pre-made list of challenges for each event. In Goal Attack, you try to beat these challenges. There are three challenges in each event. Finish first, finish the race with less than 25% damage, and finish the race in under a specific lap time. If you beat all the challenges in an event, you'll be given a star rating for all your troubles, and some money. Not too exciting of a reward, but if you see yourself as a completionist and you're looking for a challenge, then this mode is totally for you. An online mode makes a valiant return to Los Angeles. You can now challenge specific people in a cruising match without having to go to an entirely different game match or lobby if you wanted to race. Now cruisers and races can both exist in a match. In an effort to remove waiting times, matchmaking is a seamless transition, and you can just get straight into the action. Capture the Flag returns in online as well with two new Capture the Flag spin-off modes, these being Keep Away. In Keep Away, a flag will spawn somewhere in the map and an online player must grab it. Whoever keeps the flag for that longest duration of time before the timer ends, wins. And Stockpile. Instead of one flag having to be collected, three flags will show up on the map. The team who collects, or stockpiles, most of the flags, wins. The official servers, just like with Midnight Club 2 and 3, were shut down in 2014 due to the closure of GameSpy, but only for the PS3. Xbox 360 users can still play online as of the making of this video, in addition to the Xbox One users as well, due to it now being backwards compatible. However, the Rate My Ride service was shut down for all platforms. Now, what was Rate My Ride? Well, if you're an avid player of Midnight Club Los Angeles' online mode back in the day, I bet you're probably getting real giddy at this. Rate My Ride was a feature where you could buy and sell your own custom cars online. Yes, the custom car designs that you made in single player could now be viewed, rated, and even bought by others. Many people sold some, let's say, unique and creative designs. When someone buys your custom ride, you'll earn all profits from that sale, with some even earning $3 million off one car alone. So it was a straightforward way to make money. However, the idea wasn't bulletproof. You could just buy cars, resell them, and claim profits off that same car. And because you didn't get to put the car on the marketplace per se, but more shared your vehicle to a store, you kept the original vehicle and just made passive money off it. So it is a little slimy, but you gotta make your bank somehow. The service shut down in May of 2014 on both 360 and PS3, a devastating 5 years after the game's release. While these days the game's network play has been ruled by modders, if you find someone who doesn't mod that you can play it with, it can just be extremely fun to drift around or cruise through LA. In online, you can also choose between a number of characters from the career mode to drive as, which adds a rather insignificant but still a appreciated element to the player's customization. Whilst this feature is now long abandoned, Rockstar would host its own online tournaments in the game, which would work in the same way as the single player tournaments, but just online. The last online tournament hosted by Rockstar was in April of 2009, which was the Pizza Hut South Central tournament. Whoever won this tournament would win a $599 Pizza Hut gift card, enough money to buy pizza for an entire year. The race editor returns and again features lots of improvements over the Midnight Club 3 race editor. It has mostly been improved in terms of functionality than in terms of innovation. Midnight Club 3's race editor fell victim to very touchy controls, and setting checkpoints and shortcuts like alleys was a hassle. Midnight Club Los Angeles goes about fixing this, so you really do have free reign over the marker placement and far more refined controls. Midnight Club Los Angeles is also the first title in the series to feature a photo mode. Midnight Club 3 introduced the mechanic of rotating the camera around your car in the pause menu. Whilst it was cool to see your car from a nicer angle, you weren't able to take a screenshot of it in-game and save it. In Los Angeles, this mechanic is still there, but you're able to now take pictures of it in-game and save them to your own photo album. You now also have more control over the camera, so you can pan the camera, rotate, zoom in and out, general camera flexibility. Before May of 2014, you'd also be able to publish your album onto Social Club and download your in-game pictures. Collectibles are back in the form of Rockstar barrels this time. There are 60, yes, 60 yellow barrels with imprinted Rockstar logos, scattered all around the most obscure places of the map. Each 10 of them you collect, you'll be able to win cheat codes such as Infinite Nitrous, No Police During Cruise Mode, or God Mode, just to name a few.
Let me tell you a little something about LA.
I love it!
Check a name is drunk as hell at 3 in the morning. When you're snoring, I just hit the after spot without a
warning.
The soundtrack for Los Angeles was one of Rockstar's most important features during development. In order to further emphasize that Cali feel, Rockstar wanted to license music played on LA airways at the time. Rockstar had originally wanted to license around 500 or so songs at several stages of the game's development, and they had licensed music from Linkin Park, Busta Rhymes, Pharrell Williams, Dead Prez, and more. These, and among 300 or so songs, didn't quite make it into the final game. The final track list was numbed down to, still a very impressive, 97 song track list, 2 songs shy of Midnight Club 3's non-remix track list, with appearances from rock bands such as Beck, Disturbed, Social Distortion, Eagles of Death Metal, and electronic and techno acts such as The Chemical Brothers, Wolfgang Gartner, Diplo, The Chemists, and hip-hop acts such as Kid Cudi, Snoop Dogg, Ice Cube, and Will.i.am. Rockstar would now also incorporate a playlist feature reminiscent of EA Tracks, seen in various EA titles. You can now create your own music playlists and also find and play a specific song from the soundtrack. Driving down the block like what else should a brother do? It's Saturday, baby. Might smoke with you. Driving down the block, load up the serpent. Open up the trunk, baby. It's crazy kicking. Yo. Enhance your dent. I would like to say Rockstar had made impact once again. However, that unfortunately was not the case. Lots of money, resources, and dedication went into finishing Midnight Club Los Angeles, more than any project that San Diego had ever worked on. However, the final result, whilst insanely fun to play and being very polished, received reception below expectations. Rockstar San Diego and Take-Two were hoping Los Angeles would receive critical acclaim, or at least higher review scores than 3, and ultimately being a huge success for the studio. This was not the case. Whilst it was almost universally agreed upon that Los Angeles was a great game, reviewers complained about the game's difficulty curve and frustrations, and the game's lack of variety compared to Midnight Club 3. The late game just wasn't as consumer-friendly as previous installments. The game's sales were also underwhelming, selling around 5.5 million copies, around a million less than Midnight Club 3. This could have been caused by several factors. Remember the financial crisis? You know, the period between 2007 to 2008 that was considered worse than the Great Depression? Yeah, not a great time for monetized arts. Not to mention, with the success of the PS2, it meant not everyone had upgraded to the 7th gen yet. With that in mind, racing games just weren't exciting enough yet, as cited by one of the game's lead animators. By the end of production, the game looked fantastic and was a lot of fun to play. Unfortunately, reviews came back criticizing how difficult the game was at its normal mode. Midnight Club Los Angeles had a lot to offer and there were plenty who loved it, but if it had been slightly easier to play, it might have broken through and been the big success we'd hoped it would be. Don't get me wrong, Midnight Club Los Angeles wasn't a failure by any means, but it was insanely underwhelming and rather disappointing when it came to critical reception and commercial performance. Despite this, however, there were already plans for a new Midnight Club title and the release of an expansion pack for Los Angeles. Before we go into all of that, however, let's discuss the game's handheld version, released a day after the main console's version. This handheld port would feature an entirely new map and career mode not seen on the consoles. On April 21st, 2008, Rockstar Games announced that Rockstar London, another Take-Two Rockstar subsidiary, in conjunction with Rockstar San Diego, were working on a portable version of the then-up-and-coming Midnight Club Los Angeles. This port would come out exclusively on the PlayStation Portable and be released as Midnight Club Los Angeles Remix. Midnight Club LA Remix would be released on October 24th, 2008. Obviously, Rockstar wouldn't be able to port the entirety of Los Angeles seen in the console versions to a handheld. Rather, they ported the Los Angeles scene in Midnight Club 2. Whilst this is an interesting port, the downside is that they made little to no changes to the original Midnight Club 2 map. LA Remix felt no different to Midnight Club 2's, other than adding some new landmarks and stores, like Carney's for instance. This is compensated, however, by the game's day and night cycle, also seen in the console versions of the game. Now, you're able to take a look at Midnight Club 2's Los Angeles during noon. This miniature version of Los Angeles is small, and it would be pretty boring to exclusively include one map we've already seen. In Midnight Club 2, it was forgiven because there were two other areas to race through. So, Rockstar London added an additional city to the game for the handheld port, Tokyo, ported from Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition Remix. An extension to the plot was also added, along with Tokyo, a continuation of the player's story after beating Book. The story in PSP Remix is largely the same, with some races and missions seen on consoles being excluded, but it is still very faithful to the Xbox 360 and PS3 versions. Unfortunately, whilst the phone calls still remain, cutscenes, video, or in-game are excluded from the PSP port. All of the vehicles from the console versions are featured in the handheld versions, along with all of the other consoles' customization parts. The only things that aren't available in the handheld that were featured in the main versions of the game is the vinyl editor, a lack of certain performance upgrades, and obviously the cockpit customization. There are also exclusive upgrades not seen in the console versions, and whilst these were pretty much copy and paste from Midnight Club 3, they are still very cool to see returning. Stuff like customizing the color of your exhausts, the trims, etc. Cockpit view from the main LA game isn't featured in this port, obviously because the PSP would melt in your hand if it had to render up to 50 modeled interiors. Handling wise, the PSP features very nice controls. The handling is largely based off Midnight Club 3, but they did make some few subtle differences to make the cars feel a bit different from 3. All in all, however, they still feel very nice to drive and drift with, to the point where it's plausible to say that they're a bit more polished and smoother than Midnight Club 3's handling. While in the console version of Los Angeles, you get to perform the garage deal with Carol and beat the car class champs, in Remix, after beating Book, Marcus gets a call from street racing organizer Toshi, who invites him to join the Midnight Club racing team in Tokyo.
Look, I don't really need organizing, but you know, thanks for calling.
We will gladly pay for your flight to Tokyo.
Tokyo? Wait, are you talking about the Midnight Club?
I'll arrange for contact information to be sent to you. I hope to see you soon.
Whoa, hang on.
After that, you'll finally gain access to Tokyo. You start off by buying your starter car, as you cannot use the same vehicles you used in Los Angeles in Tokyo. After arriving in Tokyo, you get called again, this time by private dealership owner and car mechanic, Kazu, and challenges you to your first race, which is a race against his own brother, Aito.
While you're here, okay, my bro Aito's running a race out in Shibuya. Why don't you try out your ride down there?
Kazu, Aito, and Fumiko will then proceed to inform you about new races and new tournaments, as well as new time trials being held in Tokyo. Upon beating a series of races, Kazu will call and inform you about the Midnight Club leader, Yamagata, hosting a Midnight Club qualification tournament which, as the name suggests, will give you the opportunity to join the Midnight Club.
Hey, hey, superstar!
Hey, Kazu.
You're in, man! Yamagata's setting up a qualifying tournament. Win that and you're on your way.
Cool. What's the prize money?
What are you kidding? No money, man. This is all about rep. You know, honor. Doesn't get bigger than this. Get down there, you crazy kid, and take your best wheels.
Once you win the tournament, you'll be qualified to be a Midnight Club member. However, you're still not quite there yet.
You're good, American. You would be a worthy addition to our racing club.
Thanks. Does that mean I'm in?
Not yet. The next step is to beat the other challengers one-on-one. Beat Yoshi, Daigoro, and Junichi, and you're on your way.
Wow. You guys got a lot of hoops to jump through.
The Midnight Club is the greatest street racing club in the world. This is how we keep that title.
After jumping through another set of hoops, Marcus will then become a member of the Midnight Club, which was Marcus's main goal. Yamagata will then challenge you to more races. After another series, Marcus will then personally challenge Yamagata to a race. Not for the title of world champ, no. nor for the opportunity to be the leader of the Midnight Club, but just for the challenge.
Excellent work, my friend. Now you'll be returning to LA?
Not quite, Yamagata. Seems to me the only guy I haven't beaten in this city is you.
You challenge me? For the leadership of the Midnight Club?
No, I don't care about that. I just want to beat the best.
Then I accept.
Upon beating Yamagata, you get to replace his role in the Midnight Club and become the Tokyo Champion. Beating Yamagata concludes the Tokyo career. Wireless multiplayer returns from Midnight Club 3's PSP port with support for up to 4 people instead of 6 like in Midnight Club 3. The PSP does not feature any exclusive features other than the ones mentioned so far, and aside from that, there really isn't much to say about it. Midnight Club Los Angeles Remix, all in all, was a great port of the original, a lot better than Midnight Club 3's PSP port. These issues were all fixed with LA Remix, and it's almost impressive to say how stable the game is compared to its predecessor. Upon release, Midnight Club LA Remix received very positive review scores, more so than the previous Midnight Club on the PSP. However, it didn't quite perform as well when it came to sales, as the game managed to sell around 1 million copies, an almost disastrous 2.5 million less than the previous title. This wasn't the end for Midnight Club Los Angeles, however, as Rockstar San Diego was working on expanding the game through DLC, an idea that had only recently become a thing due to the popularity of the digital game market, and Rockstar were looking to capitalize on this trend as well.
Can't slow down the wind with pass. All ass like a bat out of hell, we move past sea bass. Track straight out ahead of the smash, you're a competitor's too late, you're the last. We're getting worse, we never meant get tossed out in the trash with the other death threats. Who cast from the city wind? Who do who checks? Start injecting them in like a steady syringe since it's hiding the wind. If you tell me that you're ready, then it's time to begin. Who cast from the city wind? Who do who checks? Start injecting them in.
In December of 2008, Rockstar quietly announced the South Central expansion that would add a whole new area to the game, add new characters, races, and music. This would be Rockstar's second venture into downloadable content, and certainly wouldn't be its last, after the release of the commercially and critically successful story expansions of Grand Theft Auto 4. It's clear that Rockstar were interested in the idea of DLCs for a long time, and Rockstar San Diego actually experimented with DLC during the development of Midnight Club 3. Rockstar's brand of DLC was like that of an expansion. Think Ballad of Gay Tony, Red Dead's Undead Nightmare, and The Lost and Damned. All fantastic single-player expansions. This same level of detail was to be expanded into Midnight Club, with the same care and love for the game. With digital stores becoming more prevalent during the 7th generation of gaming, things like downloadable content would be easier to distribute. So, Rockstar obviously wanted to try their hand in it, with the idea of an expansion pack being introduced very early on during development for some of Rockstar's 7th gen titles, including Midnight Club LA. Shortly following its 2008 announcement and an accidental January 2009 Xbox Live market leak, Rockstar shared new details on the DLC and a release date, March 12, 2009. It was pushed back for a week until finally releasing on the 19th of March, 2009 for a price of $10. The South Central DLC would add 9 new vehicles along with 7 other vehicles from 2 car packs, such as the Audi S5, the Mitsubishi Eclipse GT, the Aston Martin DB9, and the Mitsubishi Lancer Evo X. This pack would also add 2 completely new car types to the game, these being lowriders and SUVs, with examples like Range Rover, the 64 Impala, and the 66 Pontiac GTO. Aside from that, it would also add new vinyl presets, new customization features such as hydraulics and airbags, 26 new races, 10 new delivery missions, and new music from artists such as Hollywood Holt, Kid Cudi, and Scott Weiland. However, the biggest addition to the game would be an entire map expansion that would add an entire third to the already expansive Los Angeles map. This new area would be an authentic-looking recreation of South Central, with it featuring key places such as the LA Memorial Coliseum, Crenshaw Plaza, and the USC campus. If all that wasn't enough, the expansion would also add new story missions, characters, and dialogue. After finishing some of the introductory events in the story, Carol will tell you to check out the racing scene in South Central.
Hey Carol, what's up?
I just had an old friend come by the garage. His name is Doc. He owns a shop on Florence down in South Central. If you're interested, you should go find him.
And why would he interest me?
is connected with the scene down there, like your Uncle Carol is to the rest of L.A. He can hook you up with new races and new rewards.
Really? I'll have to check that out. Thanks.
A word of warning. That big mouth of yours fits in fine in Hollywood, but it's a different world down there.
He wants you to meet Doc, a car mechanic and car dealership owner located in South Central, who specializes in SUVs and lowriders. Doc would then set the player up with vehicles and races within South Central. As mentioned before, South Central also features its own missions, such as the delivery missions, time trials, wages, and pink slip races, etc., etc. On October 2009, Midnight Club Los Angeles ended up being re-released as Midnight Club Los Angeles The Complete Edition. This re-release would feature the original game along with all of the extra downloadable content that was released pre-installed onto the disc. Similar to Midnight Club 3 Dub Edition Remix, this re-release would pretty much overshadow the original Midnight Club Los Angeles, making it obsolete. Midnight Club Los Angeles was fun to play, expansive, filled with personality, and can be hailed as a technical achievement. However, unfortunately, Los Angeles does not really carry the same legacy as Midnight Club 3 has. While over the years it's gained more of a cult status amongst many racing fans, at the time of the game's release and kind of still today, a vast majority of the public still sees the game as a downgrade compared to 3 in terms of content and replay value. Which is sad, as I personally think the game is amazing, and that frankly it deserves a lot more love. As said before, the game critically and financially performed worse than the previous title, and overall, to Take-Two and Rockstar, the game turned out to be pretty underwhelming. Despite all of the negative babble, however, Rockstar San Diego wasn't deterred when it came to making a new Midnight Club, with Rockstar starting to work on a new Midnight Club game right before the release of the base game. However, these plans would come to an unfortunate and indefinite halt. In January of 2010, a blog posted to the gaming website Gamma Sutra detailed the accounts of Rockstar San Diego's abysmal working conditions, which were posted by someone under the alias Rockstar Spouse on behalf of several disgruntled fiancés of some of Rockstar San Diego's employees, in an effort to stop the abhorrent working conditions in the studio. According to the lengthy post, conditions began to deteriorate at the San Diego studio during the release of the South Central DLC, as management in the studio began enforcing mandatory 12-hour workdays and extended the work week to Saturday. To quote, "The managers at Rockstar San Diego continued in their dishonesty, pushing their employees to the brink by promising temporariness, fully equipped with the knowledge of another deadline just around the corner." There have been allegations that due to the grueling deadlines and awfully manipulative management, many employees showed signs of depression and some were displaying suicidal tendencies. Shortly after this was posted, a user under the name Bitter Party of Many, who had also had connections to the studio, offered some of his or her own allegations, such as, to quote, "Where is the details about people getting performance warnings for not working 11 hours plus a day?" Continuing on, they had lost some of the best graphics and optimization people in the industry because of their attitude and management style. What they're left with is a few managers who nobody believes deserves their position, or who nobody likes or respects, and some very talented developers who are waiting for the project to end so that they can move on. You're not just going to get the best work out of people when they don't like or trust or respect their managers. But the most relevant and devastating claim is, to quote, "Please, someone explain why the profitable and very functional Midnight Club team was ripped apart, their technology thrown away after Midnight Club Los Angeles, and everyone who wasn't fired or quit was shoved onto a project that had been struggling for well over 4 years. Whilst we only have speculation and comments from anonymous sources online, an imaginative mind could conclude that those at Rockstar San Diego were worked to the bone, and critical work was disregarded. Searching through job review sites reflect this, however we cannot confirm if these were fraudulent reviews or not, but this reflects the extracts. If, and only if, this argument holds water, it is unethical how Rockstar treated its employees, and due to poor management and working environments, we may have lost one of the best arcade races of all time. This is certainly not an isolated incident, We know for certain that Konami are guilty of this too, and if we are to consider that Konami joins Rockstar among the upper echelon of game developers, then we can correlate these instances and claims and make assumptions, but that is all. So what can be confirmed of all this? A Midnight Club 5 was definitely in development, and was confirmed by several ex-Rockstar employees, but cancelled sometime in 2009 or 2010. Aside from the bad working conditions, there may be several more reasons why a new Midnight Club didn't materialize, and most definitely will not. The success of Red Dead Redemption. If you have been living under a rock, Red Dead Redemption was a sandbox title in the same vein as GTA 5, only this time in the Wild West. It was developed by Rockstar San Diego as well, and was in development ever since Midnight Club 3 was released. It came out in 2010 and became the 5th best-selling game of the year, selling around 3 to 4 times as many copies as Midnight Club Los Angeles had. The success of Red Dead Redemption and the disappointing release of Midnight Club LA might have resulted in Rockstar San Diego losing faith and hope into creating a new Midnight Club. To follow up, Grand Theft Auto 5. Whilst this one is a little bit more nitpicky, GTA 5 might have had a helping hand in the discontinuation of the Midnight Club franchise. Rockstar San Diego was ordered to help Rockstar North develop their magnum opus ever since the game started development back in 2009. You can notice that after Red Dead Redemption, Rockstar San Diego hadn't developed any new titles, and this might have been due to them helping with the development of GTA 5. GTA 5, or more specifically GTA Online, also changed Take-Two's and Rockstar's business strategy, as GTA 5 became a marketing mogul amongst the video game world, with the introduction of a slow trickling of online content that can be made quickly obtainable with the in-game transactions, a trend that has now become more relevant in a contemporary context. Rockstar's business model was to create large-sized, high-quality video games, and whilst they haven't deviated from that, they now have a consistent revenue stream in their microtransactions. This could be a motive to not create any new video games consistently. There's really no revenue like consistent revenue. Whatever the case, Midnight Club 5 was to be, but never arrived. Considering the state of video game trends today, I don't think that it will be likely we will ever see a new Midnight Club game again. It remains a relic, carved into the eras that remember it so fondly, and you and I will remember it for what it was. Dumb, fast fun.
Cali. I'm moving down the freeway, stepping on the gas, switching my gears, trying not to crash. The bright city lights got me moving so fast, 120 on the dash, chasing that cash. You can say I'm speeding, tearing up the cement, flying by the cops like I ain't even see them. Driving through LA, right through downtown, flying through traffic, I gotta slow down. I gotta take it easy, but I don't know how. 22-inch rims sitting low to the ground. When I dip, they scraping, check my location. I'm getting road rage, I ain't got no patience. I'm running red lights, talking on the phone, riding shotgun with glasses Malone. We West Coast on, plus static on the beach, Midnight Club, I'm a savage on the streets.
Welcome to a segment I want to call Midnight Club Facts! Yeah! I'm going to show you quick five facts. I'm going to show you five quick facts about Midnight Club you probably didn't even know about. Cool, brah! Here's fact number one. Did you know that a model for the Nissan GT-R R35 is present in the files for Midnight Club LA? Well, this is and has only been discovered recently. Through the help of some simple reverse engineering, can be brought out and driven in-game. Has its own cockpit view with all the working gauges, some rims, which can only be found in the Australian version of the game, brah, customizable parts, and a garage icon. Seems that the car was cut real late, but it seems real cool that it can be brought back in the game. There's also some references to some choppers, a Gambala Avalanche, and a Mercedes-Benz CL500. Yo, that's epic, brah! Here's another fact concerning some removed content. Did you know that Midnight Club 3 had a couple of unused loading themes? They were only found recently, and there are about 13 unused loading tracks from artists not featured in the game. If you want to listen to them, visit the second channel, Super Top 1, or check that description. Here's fact number 3! Not directly Midnight Club related, however, did you know that Juice Games, creator of the rival street racer game Juice, wrote in their brand plan, which dates back to a few months before Midnight Club 3's release, that Midnight Club 3's racing was actually likely to be average and features a basic driving model? Yeah, I wonder what happened to you guys. Oh, wait. Get out, brah. Here's fact number 4, dudes. Check this out. Did you know that the iconic kanji text featured in the Midnight Club's logo was omitted from the Japanese release of the games? This most likely had to be related to some form of copyright, because as said before, the letters were translated into Wangan, a highway in Tokyo. And finally, dude, here's the final fact. Fact number 5, brah!
Midnight Club features vehicles that have engines that allow them to move and stuff.
Fucking sick! Wow! Yeah! So that's it for this episode of Midnight Club Facts. Brah, donate so I can feed my family. They live in Uganda, I can't feed them, and they're probably being dominated by Ugandan warlords that I can't even control or kill.
So you made it to the end of the video. Thank you so much for watching. But before you click away, we just want to announce some stuff real quick. Grand Theft Aero and I will be doing a podcast in the not-so-distant future, and we're going to be calling it The Memory Card. I know, very original. Our first episode will be centered around talking about the production of the video, our final thoughts, and a little bit of gameplay to keep you satisfied as well. We'll take some questions and just discuss anything Midnight Club related or any future videos you'd like to see, like that most wanted video you promised. A link to that podcast channel will be in the description. It'd be fantastic to talk to you once this video is all done with. This has been the culmination of about 6 months of hard work, with about 350 to 400 hours of editing, 250 hours of just replaying the entirety of every Midnight Club game, and also around 100 hours of writing. It's been an insane journey, and we're just insane just to get it out the door. It's mental. Lastly, are you a fan of that Midnight Club LA soundtrack? Well, if you check out his second channel, you can have a look at some of the songs that didn't quite make the final cut. Bit of interesting trivia to keep that Midnight Club knowledge pool open, and you'll also find some great music to listen to. Link to that will be in the description. You like YouTube videos? Well, I make some YouTube videos sometimes. Check me out, my name is Figus. Of course, there'll be a little annotation or a link in the description or whatever Grand Theft Aero decides to give me credit for. And I find some of my videos funny, so maybe you will too.
How's it going, everyone? Billowing Dick Sponge here, and today we're going to be talking about something incredibly relevant. We're going to be complaining about Figus's new video about Escape from Tarkov.
Actually know how a commentary video go. This trend is fucking dead. This trend is dead. No one's laughing about this shit anymore. I don't actually fucking know what to say.
Play that shit.
And night! Holy shit!
It's shit. It's shit.
From the whole team here, thank you so much for watching.
Later, homes!